Scholastic Audio presents The Crystal Ribbon by Celeste Lim, read by Nancy Wu. Chapter 1. An Unusual Birthday. If someone had told me 2 years ago that I would be married the year I turned 11, I would have laughed at them and said, "But boys are filthy and stupid like oxen. I shan't get married. Besides, my papa loves me more than any husband in the world could." But that was before. It was early spring, and for my 11th birthday, Grandmama had agreed to slaughter a chicken. Something more than our regular rice gruel manto buns, legumes and bland corn broth. Just for me. But when everyone sat down, the topic of marriage came to join us at our table. Aunt May was telling Papa about this maiden in the village who recently got engaged to a nice family, but Papa only nodded and gazed intently into his bowl, as though trying to count the grains of rice in it. I dared to interrupt. "What will happen to Ling Ling after she gets married, Papa?" I'd long ago learned that if I directed my questions or comments at Papa, I would be less likely to get reprimanded for interrupting a grown-up conversation. Papa never minded my questions and would even laugh if my comments were witty. But this time, Papa did not even look at me. Instead, he started chewing on the ends of his wooden chopsticks. My heart plummeted faster than a rock down a ravine. I stopped eating. "Papa, what happens after someone gets married?" Papa looked around at the other grown-ups, but when both Grandmama and Aunt May said nothing, he sighed and scratched at the stubble on his neck.
"Well, Jing, when a girl gets married, she leaves her family and goes to live with another."
Immediately, Wei's hand clasped mine underneath the table. My little brother didn't like the idea any more than I did. Leave my family to live with someone else? I imagined waking up one day with a completely different family. Voices I didn't know, faces I didn't recognize, people I didn't care about. I'd hate them. I'd be miserable. I gave Papa what he usually called my I know better look. "Then I don't ever want to get married. I want to stay here forever."
"Don't be silly, child,"
Aunt May cried, flourishing the sharp end of her chopsticks just inches from my nose. A single grain of rice spewed out of her mouth and landed on the plum sauce roasted chicken.
"What a disgrace to the Li family you'll be if you don't get married," she continued. "When the time comes, you will wed."
To my surprise, even Grandmama nodded as she picked up a piece of pickled carrot.
"We will have to start looking for a suitable family soon."
Aunt May probably needed a suitable family more than I did, but I knew better than to answer back, for it was seen as great disrespect for children to do so. Aunt May was Papa's older sister and had been married to Uncle Tai, a blacksmith in our village. Having no in-laws, she eventually came back to live with us after Uncle Tai died at war 9 years ago. No one ever mentioned that Aunt May should remarry, but back when she was still alive, Mama had told me that men rarely considered widowed or divorced women as wives because they were thought to bring bad luck. One time, I asked, "Why then do we keep Aunt May with us if she's bad luck?" And Mama had hitched on such a stern look that I never dared ask again. After breakfast, Wei and I kneeled in front of the small wooden altar on the ground beside our front door. On it were three tablets carved out of bamboo. Two of them belonged to deities, Guan Yin, the goddess of mercy, and the great golden Huli Jing, the guardian fox Jing of our village. The last one was Mama's mortuary tablet, and on it were the words written in red, "Here be the place of early departed daughter-in-law of Li,
Wu Cai Hua.
I brought my hands together, holding a lit incense stick, and bowed thrice. I closed my eyes.
Mama, I don't want to go to another family. Please watch over me. Don't let me leave you.
Finally, I stuck my incense into the incense holder, moved back, and touched my forehead to the ground in a kowtow. Then Pan began to wail from his reed cradle, and from the fitful way he cried, I could tell he was uncomfortable from wetting himself. I hurried with the clean rag into the room Wei and I shared. At about 20 moons, Pan was still a wrinkly little thing. His nose turned slightly upward like a pig's snout, especially whenever he cried, which was why I called him Juju. Ever since Mama left us after giving birth to Pan, I had been put in charge of caring for him. Wei and I had believed the reason we lost Mama was because of Pan. The midwife said that Mama had bled too much. But Grandmama did not take the responsibility away from me, even though I hated it so much. I had sulked and cried and sulked. I hated the idea of Pan replacing Mama in our family, and Grandmama would often scold me for being neglectful in my babysitting. On my cruelest day, I even left Pan in the daisy field on purpose, thinking that wolves could have him. But no one ever found out my horrid deed, because as I left, my heart started to feel as though someone was using a soy grinder on it. Pan was only a baby. He never meant to cause Mama's death. He hadn't asked to be born. Mama had birthed him out of love, and here I was, trying to harm the son for whom she had given her life. Would I really dishonor my mother like that? I had gone back for Pan, and from then on, I made a promise that I would love him as much as Mama would have if she were alive. I would be the Mama Pan would never have. And in that way, I kept Mama alive in my heart.
Juju, it's time for breakfast,
I crooned as I nudged a spoon of rice gruel mixed with goat's milk to his mouth. Then Papa poked his head into the room.
Jing, come down to the farm later. It's time to dry out the tea leaves.
Wei let out a squeal, and my heart missed a couple of beats. Was Papa finally allowing us to help with tea drying? But there was something else.
Papa, are we going up to the Huli Jing shrine today?
It was the first week of spring on the lunar calendar, which was when every family in the village prepared offerings from our harvests and produce to pay homage to the tutelary spirit of Huanan Village, a powerful five-tailed fox Jing known as the Great Golden Huli Jing. Sure enough, Baba nodded.
Yes, afternoon. Aunt May is helping Grandmama prepare our offerings, so I'll need your help on the farm. Don't be too long.
There was a knowing grin on Papa's face as he left, and I couldn't wait for tea drying time. After Juju finished his food, I placed him in his wooden playpen where Grandmama could watch him from the kitchen, and I dashed out the front door with Wei behind me. Our village was small, with only 2 streets, a wider one that led to the village square, where there was a cluster of hawker stalls and a smaller dirt path that went an entire circle around the village, leading to the wooden huts of 29 families. I always thought this made a shape like a copper coin, a circle with a square in the center. Wei and I weaved in and out among the stalls on the bustling street. I barely dodged Pong's flower cart, heaped with early violet columbines. Huanan Village was settled halfway up the east side of a hill. Behind our house was higher ground, and a stream running from farther up the hill provided the irrigation our farmlands needed. Beyond the bamboo fences that surrounded our village were patches of carefully plowed land. Each family had their own plot, and in ours, Papa grew simple crops such as jujubes, prunes, tea leaves, and various legumes. The farm was always busiest during the day. When we arrived, villagers already dotted the entire plot like sesame seeds on rice. Wide-brimmed straw hats pulled over their heads to keep out the sun. We found Papa in our harvest shed, checking on the condition of the tea leaves we had picked a few days ago. The young flushes had been loosely scattered on straw-woven trays, and Papa had a small pinch of them under his nose. The room was airy and filled with the slightly stale scent of wilted tea leaves. I walked up to another tray and rolled a little pinch of leaves gently between my fingers. Still slightly springy, but dry around the edges. I could be wrong, but they should be ready for the walk. Sure enough, Papa gave a satisfied grunt.
These will make a fine batch of black tea indeed. It's time to dry them out completely. Wei, go get our biggest wok.
Wei practically floated out of the shed, and I could see why. Black tea was popular and usually sold for a lot of money, especially in the colder seasons. Harvesting a good batch at this time of the year could easily mean a more comfortable winter. By the time Wei came back with a metal wok as big as a cartwheel, Papa had already moved a few trays outside, and we were making heat from a pile of embers inside a stack of bricks.
Papa, Grandmama says we need to head over to the shrine soon,
Wei reported as I helped him set up the wok.
We won't have time to finish drying all of them.
Papa nodded, placing his bare hands on the wok to test the heat. After making sure the temperature was just right, he tossed in the first tray of leaves.
Well, we'll get at least a few trays done so some of them can be given to the shrine as part of our offering.
No. Our family had hardly enough to feed ourselves as it was. Couldn't Papa see that offering the tutelary spirit such good crops that would otherwise earn us money was a horrible waste? This was unfair. This was ridiculous. Couldn't the Fox Jing get food for itself? Why did it have to depend on our offerings? I couldn't help telling Papa exactly what I thought.
Jing, you mustn't speak disrespectfully of the great golden Huli Jing.
Even when berating me, Papa managed to sound gentle. With his bare hands, he began to deftly toss and stir the black curly flushes in the wok.
The pact between Huanan Village and its spirit guardian goes back more than 30 years. Our village owes the golden Huli Jing a great debt.
I know. I cut Baba off and squatted to fan the embers underneath the wok with a straw fan. If not for the Huli Jing, we wouldn't be here at all. I'd heard the story so many times I could tell it backward. Every child in the village grew up listening to the tale about how the great golden Huli Jing saved Huanan from a fatal bandit raid some 30 years ago. I wondered if Baba would berate me some more for interrupting, but he only nodded.
I understand why you do not feel the same way. But the grown-ups in Huanan view our guardian much in the same way as the people of Song view our Emperor Taizu, who ended the upheaval of the 10 kingdoms and birthed our glorious dynasty of Song. So, to Papa at least, that incident 30 years ago was truly something else. I was hardly older than you myself when it happened.
For Papa's benefit, I tried to imagine what it would have felt like to have seen the epic battle with my own eyes. In my mind, I was atop the village watchtower like Papa had been, just behind the outer fences, shielding my face against the howling storm as a line of burning torches encircled the village. The trepidation was real, just like the relief must have been when in the nick of time a giant 5-tailed Fox Jing had appeared and fought off the ring of 50 bandits before they could raid and burn the entire village. Such a narrow escape from death would not have been forgotten easily. Wei leapt off his perch on a wooden stool.
Papa, if I were you, I'd have jumped off that watchtower like this and given those bandits a few good whacks with my shovel, he exclaimed as he kicked and punched the air in front of him. I wouldn't have needed any old Huli Jing to save me.
Baba only laughed as he tossed the tea leaves with his bare hands, not seeming to mind the heat from the walk at all. He was tough like that. People even called him the Man of the Iron Palm. Thin wisps of steam from the drying flushes rose above the walk, carrying a fresh, woody aroma. I took a deep whiff.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.